We are currently analyzing the heap layout of sudo. We do this because we try to find a suitable exploit strategy for the heap overflow. Last video, we wrote a GDB Jeff extension to trace malloc and freeze in order to learn more about the objects actually being allocated. And then we integrated it into our fuzzer. Our fuzzer always runs until we find a crash, and then we check the heap information with our plugin. Anyway, we have ran the script now for a while, and it's time to look at our findings. Just to recap what the GDB extension does and what the resulting file names from our fuzzer mean. The plugin traces each malloc and free and uses the function backtrace to remember which function called the malloc. And then when we reach our heap overflow in set command, we look at the allocations we remembered coming right after our buffer we can overflow. So the function names somewhat tell us what kind of objects we can overflow. And the file name with the fuzzing results is made up of these function names. So the file names tell us that we had a seg fault and the objects after our buffer are related to those functions. And the first thing you might notice is that some object allocations were much more common than others. Either they appear more in the list or the file size is bigger and had more cases. Which might be something we want to consider regarding how reliable it is to get the heap layout we want. But let's look a bit closer. A few of those functions I already know pretty well from all the code I read, but there are a few that really caught my eye. For example, this one, dlopen and sudo load plugin. The function dlopen loads the dynamic library file named by the null terminated string filename. And why this sounds awesome is that shared objects may export functions using the attribute constructor. Constructor functions are executed before dlopen returns. So if we can control the path to dlopen, we would have code execution. But be careful, don't get too excited. This trace only tells us that the buffer allocated after our overflowing buffer was allocated in this function. So this dlopen probably happened before we had our overflow, and there are just some objects left from it on the heap. You can confirm this when you click on the file. In there you can see more of the objects that come after our buffer and the backtrace of the seg fault. Comparing those two, the objects seem unrelated to the backtrace. The backtrace of the crash shows that the crash was related to some NSS check user passwd stuff, but the objects were about plugin loading, which tells me that the objects right after our buffer were not the interesting ones. There should be another buffer much further away that then led to this crash. So this test case, or rather the information about the object, is not useful for us here. By the way, besides the text log of the identified buffers and backtrace, I also log every set of arguments and environment variables in a JSON file. This can be used to reproduce a particular crash. To do that, I wrote a small Python script that takes such a JSON file and you specify which test case you want, because the JSON file contains all the test cases. So it could be the first, second, or whatever, and then the script calls GDB and runs sudo edit with those parameters. This is very helpful to quickly get a debugging setup to investigate a test case. So let's look at the first crash by letting the code run, and you see it stops at the moment where we had our heap overflow in set command. And then we can continue and we run into the actual crash. And this is how I investigated some crashes just to better understand what happens. For example, in this case, we crash in tsearch, and looking at the call stack, it's actually quite interesting. Here's a function called nslookupfunction, and lookupfunction sounds really interesting. I don't know what kind of function it looks up, but if we crash inside of this, then maybe we can influence what function is getting looked up, and maybe we can do something with that. Really, really interesting crash. Definitely keep that one in mind. I spent some more time going through the different crashes, but after a bit I noticed that maybe the data is not that useful. Right now I sorted them based on what objects came after the vulnerable buffer. I thought that that is interesting, but looking at where it actually crashes, it often has nothing to do with the objects coming right after our buffer. Like I showed you earlier with the dlopen example, we crash somewhere else. As mentioned earlier, this probably happened because the object that led to the crash comes much further away on the heap, but we only log the first objects coming after our buffer in the filename. And so at this stage I thought it would be better to take a step back and look again at the different crashing functions and sort the test cases that way. This might seem like backtracking to an earlier version of this heap analysis script, but we still have the heap object information from our GDB script, which we didn't have before. So I changed the script just a little bit to create a filename based on the backtrace of the crashing function, and let's run this for a while. I mean, this doesn't give us any different results, just differently sorted. And I was just wondering if we can learn more from that. Now watch this beautiful dog run in slow motion while the fuzzing script runs. Okay, it ran for a bit and we have collected a few more crashes. It's time to get a quick overview. These crashes in set command are weird because this is the function where we have our overflow. So it crashes super early. I'm not sure what to make of it, maybe this is something cool, but I don't think so. Another crash we see is in the exit handler. I quickly peek into the crash condition, but I don't see anything useful either. This getText crash is also weird. We crash in a string compare. Also probably not interesting. Though a really cool crash seems to be those errors related to free. Here we control the address to a free call. In a more complex program where there is more interaction going on, this would be a good exploit primitive. It would allow us to free any object on the heap, which means we can turn some other part of the program into a use after free condition, which can be quite powerful. Though in the sudo case, probably not very useful. Remember, we have one shot and we need to succeed. But now we come to the ones that are more interesting, these NSS lookup function crashes. We have quite a few variations of them and lookup function just sounds so good. We should really look into what's up with that. However, this code is not part of sudo, it's part of libc, which initially turned me off. It's always a bit dreadful to look into a huge library like libc. But I guess we have no other choice. Because it would be too much for this video, let's do that next time. But for those of you who are motivated, here's again the call stack. Feel free to look into the sudo source code yourself and see what the code does. And then head into the libc code as well. It's really good practice. And elixirbutlin.com/glibc is a good site to do that. In next video, we will do this together so you can compare your thoughts with mine. Also, because this video is a bit shorter and I didn't have anything useful to add before diving into libc, I thought I'd use this opportunity to thank my patrons and YouTube members. A video series like this is obviously not very popular. Only huge nerds like you watch this. I'm not super motivated by the numbers, obviously. Otherwise, you would see me only do casual news videos. I make the videos I wish I had when I started out, and I hope you agree that this series is quite a unique learning resource. And so I really appreciate the patrons and YouTube members who pay it forward without really getting anything special in return. A typical video in this series maybe earns $40 to $50, which I hope you agree is nothing compared to the time it costs me to create those videos. So you members really make a difference to justify to work on a series like this. Thank you so much. And by the way, this was an old school video without a face. What do you like more? The previous episodes with face? Does it help to have a face to be less boring? Or does it hinder the technical details? Please let me know in the comments.